A couple of years ago, I installed a DIY solar panel system on this cabin where I film and edit these videos. But I'm normally out at work during the day when the panels are generating their free electricity. So in order for me to get the benefit of that energy, the system I installed had to include these things. Two very large leisure batteries, or leisure batteries if you're of an American persuasion. And if you scale all this up to the level of a national grid, then it's this basic principle that makes the whole renewable energy thing a genuinely realistic option for displacing fossil fuels once and for all. In the 2 years since I installed my system, energy storage technology and production has experienced massive growth all over the world. So who's leading and who's lagging? And who's going to win the race for global supremacy? Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. On the 20th of September 2017, Hurricane Maria pummeled the island territory of Puerto Rico and gave us all a little glimpse of how vulnerable our huge centralized power generation facilities will be to the increasingly extreme weather events that are becoming more and more commonplace around the world as a result of climate change. During the 12 months following the disaster, Tesla installed or commenced installing no fewer than 11,000 solar and storage projects on the island, shipping 1,000 container-sized batteries providing power to 662 locations. Several power outages in the central electricity transmission of South Australia in late 2016 and early 2017 provoked a big national debate about energy security in that country. A Twitter exchange between Elon Musk and Australian billionaire Mike Cannon-Brookes resulted in 100 megawatts of Tesla batteries being installed in just 100 days next to a large wind farm north of Adelaide. The installation was derided as a gimmick by some political Neanderthals at the time.
By all means, have the world's biggest battery, have the world's biggest banana, have the world's biggest prawn, like we have on the roadside along the highways around the country. But that's not solving the problem.
But recent interviews with the people who actually operate the state grid system there tell a different story.
We sense something on the system and the automated protection kicks in, then a battery can operate at around 200 to 250 milliseconds, so very much sub 1 second response to be able to protect the systems.
This is the market operator's instruction. This is the response of a conventional power station. The battery is far swifter and more accurate.
It's not just Tesla, of course. Most of the big global battery makers are getting involved in grid storage and domestic storage systems. From a starting point back in 2009, global growth in energy storage was steady, if unremarkable, until fairly recently. But now, it's climbing a curve that looks pretty exponential. And it's actually South Korea, thanks to LG Chem and Samsung, who topped the charts for the most energy storage installed in 2018. So it's pretty clear that grid operators around the world are welcoming the growth in renewable energy and battery storage, not only from an environmental point of view, but also from a pragmatic engineering point of view, because of the extremely valuable role it plays in smoothing out the peaks and troughs in energy demand. Here in Europe, though, the biggest driver of energy storage in the last couple of years has actually been behind the meter. In other words, relatively small battery storage systems inside homes and businesses, as opposed to the very large systems that are part of the centralized grid. These smaller individual storage systems are typically combined with solar panel installations on the roofs of our homes and businesses. One of the most significant technological initiatives being rolled out across the continent right now is something called the smart grid, which combines the domestic energy storage systems in our homes with smart meters to create a decentralized distributed network of energy generation and consumption across national borders. The smart meters know when excess energy is being generated in the home and can send that energy back to the grid to be used almost instantaneously wherever it's most needed, anywhere on the grid system from town to town or even country to country. And in a few short years when most people will be driving electric vehicles, they'll also contribute to the smoothing of the electrical demand spikes. Whenever and wherever they're plugged into a smart charger, they can be set to charge or discharge depending on the needs of the individual driver and the overall needs of the grid system. Domestic home battery systems are also gaining traction over there in the United States, But the motivation for most Americans for investing in this technology is actually to get yourselves some measure of independence from a rather dilapidated and somewhat unreliable grid system that was built back in the 1890s. Despite piecemeal upgrades over the decades, 70% of the United States electrical network has components that are more than 25 years old. The need for radical overhaul of this aging infrastructure is well accepted in the States. According to Wikipedia, support for a smart grid became federal policy as far back as 2007. Since then, though, very little has happened to actually implement such a system, not least because US energy regulators demand robust cost-benefit analysis from utility company investments. And it's much easier for those utility companies to justify the cost of simply replacing existing components with new parts than it is for them to show how they'll recoup the costs of implementing an entirely new smart grid system. So it's actually the regulatory framework itself that needs a major overhaul over in the States before any kind of nationwide initiative can be put in place. And let's also remind ourselves that once a smart grid is implemented over there in the States, it will of course be far easier to move away from fossil fuels and into renewable energy sources. Now, if I was a cynical man, and I appreciate you good folks out there know that I'm not, but if I was, I might suggest that there may possibly be some sort of political lobbying going on in the background to try and slow the process down as much as possible. Nevertheless, according to this report at Green Tech Media, the US energy storage market has projects in the pipeline totaling a record-breaking 33 gigawatts. And renewable energy sources also continue to go from strength to strength, despite the lackluster support from the current administration. Here's the top 10 states for solar generation, for example. There's some impressive numbers in this list, and you can see that it's not just the large number of homes getting their power from renewable energy that makes this such an encouraging move towards the future, but it's also the number of jobs that are being created in the sector. Eventually, the United States will have to find a way to radically overhaul its national grid. Here's economist Jeremy Rifkin.
The coming together of this revolution will involve every industry: telecom, cable, ICT, consumer electronics, transport, logistics, construction, and real estate, all the retrofitting, all the industries are involved. And it means work. What I'm suggesting here is that we have one last surge of massive employment involving semi-skilled, unskilled, professional, and conceptual labor. We have to build out this smart infrastructure. Robots aren't going to do this. We have to take the entire energy complex of the United States. Think of all the infrastructure and all the technology, all those stranded assets. We have to convert all of that infrastructure from fossil fuel nuclear to distributed renewable energy.
Meanwhile, over in the world's largest democracy, India, 2018 saw major advances in both renewable power sources and energy storage. According to Energy Storage News, distributed advanced storage deployment in the country has already crossed the 2 gigawatt hour benchmark. Still a long way off providing an overall solution for 1.4 billion people, but nevertheless an encouraging step in the right direction. And India has great ambition to become a world leader in renewable technologies. The report goes on to tell us, during the first half of the year, India installed 4.9 gigawatts of solar power and secured the position of the second largest solar market in the world. The country will soon become the global solar hub, with some of the largest solar parks in the world, as government has approved plans for 14 solar parks as part of the national solar mission of reaching 100 gigawatts solar by 2022. But arguably, the most significant beneficiary of this growing energy revolution could be the vast continent of Africa. You could pretty much fit the United States, India, and China within the map of Africa. And yet, in the area below the Sahara Desert, almost 600 million people still live without reliable access to electricity. Wind and solar power installations are accelerated in most sub-Saharan countries, but it's energy storage that will really be transformational to people's lives down there. Back in February, a major event took place in Cape Town, South Africa, designed to promote the rapid advancement of sustainable energy solutions across the African continent. Entitled Batteries, Energy Storage and the Renewable Future, the event hosted 200 participants from international companies including Tesla, General Electric, Fluence and Siemens. According to this commentary from the World Bank, The event focused on the potential for batteries and other forms of energy storage to complement renewable energy by supporting off-grid and mini-grids, which supply electricity to millions of people living in remote communities or areas that are not supported by traditional infrastructure. It also demonstrated the tremendous demand that exists in the region today for energy solutions that don't just boost the uptake of clean energy, but also help stabilise and strengthen existing electricity grids and aid the global push to adopt more clean energy and fight against climate change. Most reasonably minded people have by now realised that it'll be the poorest and most vulnerable people in the world who will bear the brunt of the often very brutal consequences of climate change. New technologies that combine renewables like solar and wind with energy storage in batteries, either at grid level or crucially at small-scale microgrid or even individual domestic level, will give these people greater independence and provide a secure source of heat, light and power. And that not only means less reliance on older, potentially dangerous technologies like kerosene lamps and stoves, it also provides essential power to build better houses and infrastructure, all of which will greatly increase the resilience and ability of communities to cope with future extreme weather events. And for individuals, it means greater ability to work and study during the evenings and improve educational and vocational prospects. Not only does that give those people a bit of a leg up in the world, but history also shows that better educated populations, particularly with better educated women and girls, have lower birth rates, which in a continent with a population currently predicted to double in the next 30 years, can only be a good thing. That's it for this week. Please do give us a like and a share if you found the programme useful and informative. You can also subscribe to the channel if you haven't already done so. We've just passed through the 12,000 subscriber mark, so a massive thank you to all those of you out there who've already joined the gang. It does make a difference in getting these videos noticed by the YouTube search algorithms, which in turn means we get the message to more and more people each week. And if you click on the notification bell as well, then you'll be kept up to date whenever the new programmes come out. To find the subscribe button, all you need to do is click on that link there. As always, thanks very much for watching, have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.